Cheryl, I know you're working on it. It was live and now it's not anymore, though, on Facebook, just in case you know that.
It's coming up now.
Hi everyone, we're ready to get started, but we're just going to let people come in from the waiting room and we'll start in about 1 minute. Thank you for tuning in. Hello, everyone. Welcome to tonight's webinar, Saving Lives Campaign, bringing Cuba's example to the United States and Canada during the global pandemic. This is part of the International U.S.-Cuba Normalization Weekend of Action Against the U.S. Blockade on Cuba, which began last night with a very successful, beautiful, and moving concert with artists from the United States, Canada, Quebec, and Cuba coming together against the US blockade, and continued this morning with an opening session that sent a powerful message to the United States administration, both the existing and the new one coming up, that we are prepared to unite together to fight against this over 60 years criminal and brutal U.S. blockade. My name is Allison Bodine. I'm a social justice activist, writer, and researcher in Canada. I am the coordinator of the Fire This Time Movement for Social Justice, Venezuela Solidarity Campaign, and I'm on the editorial board of the Fire This Time newspaper, as well as I am the author of Revolution and Counter-Revolution in Venezuela, published on Battle of Ideas Press. I am speaking to you tonight from the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Squamish First Nations. And I want to invite everyone else tuning in from around the world, but especially the United States and Canada, to recognize the territories of the Indigenous peoples of which they are participating in from today. I'm really honored to be here with everyone, from distinguished doctors and medical professionals to activists and community organizers that have come together in the Saving Lives campaign to promote US, Cuba, Canada medical cooperation and really vow to make the advances that Cuba, the powerful example that Cuba has been making against the coronavirus, an issue for people in the United States and Canada that are facing escalating COVID-19 cases and all of the other crises caused by the mismanagement of the United States and Canada governments of this pandemic. I would also like to introduce my co-chair tonight for this evening. Pombana Gudo Bassett is joining us here from New Orleans.
Greetings to all. It's such an honor to be with you. As Allison shared, we've had such a successful weekend thus far, calling for 2021 to be the year that we end the US blockade against Cuba. And as she said, my name is Pombana Gudo Bassett. I'm an organizer from Harare, Zimbabwe, and from New York, from the Lenape territories. And currently I'm co-directing the Cuba program with the Witness for Peace Solidarity Collective. And I'm part of various Caribbean-wide campaigns for reparations for colonialism and also for collective land tenure, definitely related to these struggles. And I'm calling in from New Orleans, from Bulbancha, the territories of the Chitimacha, the Kwasati, the Jena Band of Choctaw, the Tunica Biloxi, the Takapa Ishak, the Adai Kado, the Biloxi Chitimacha Confederation of Muscogee, the Choctaw Apache community of Ibar, the Clifton Choctaw, the Four Winds Louisiana Cherokee Confederacy, the Grand Kailu, the Duloc Band, the Isle de Jean Charles Band, the Pointe aux Chênes and the United Homa Nation, and the many Maroon communities. These are ancestral lands as well as lands to which indigenous peoples were forcibly displaced. And as Allison shared, we recognize that people are calling from all over the world. We've had folks tune in from, you know, almost every point of the globe, and particularly tuning in from Cuba, from Canada, from the US. And we all recognize that there's much work to decolonize. And we believe that ending the US blockade is connected to that work for self-determination, for justice, for peace, for life with dignity, for all oppressed peoples, for Black peoples, indigenous peoples, peoples who've been forcibly displaced from the global South. And today, with over 245,000 people having lost their lives to COVID in what's called the United States, now is the time to learn from Cuba and to end this blockade so that people can live, so that we can have people-to-people exchanges that are rooted in the well-being of all.
Thank you, Pombana. I am here in order to also let people know just some of the ground rules for our webinar here tonight. We wanted to really invite people to ask questions, to think about how you can get involved in your own community in the US, Canada, Quebec, and beyond. But we invite people to please use the Q&A function that's at the bottom in the center of your screen. And you can also type in the chat, but it's harder for us to track questions that way. So if you have a question, please make sure to use the question and answer box. And save your questions towards the end is when we'll answer them all. We have a really great panel of speakers here tonight, which we'll hear more about.
Absolutely. So the order of speakers goes as follows. We'll begin with Dr. Samira Adri, who's a graduate of the Latin American School of Medicine, ELAM, and a current staff member of IFCO Pastors for Peace. Then we'll have Dr. Andy Coates, physician who's on the front lines of COVID-19 in Albany, New York. Then we'll have John Kirk, professor who studies Cuban medical internationalism. Then Allison and I will talk about the Saving Lives campaign, specifically the three main pillars or calls to action for the campaign. And then we'll see some really brilliant and clear videos on the passing of local resolutions, where key organizers and community members who've made possible numerous city resolutions will speak about the process and share advice for how to join in that cause. And then Allison and I will talk to you all about medical collaboration, some of the specific possibilities, such as public health forums and exchanges, that people such as Dr. John Oswald, who will be speaking next, have been part of. He will speak to important life-saving collaborations between the University of Minnesota Hospital and Medic. Then we will have Nachito Herrera, who is a leading Cuban musician, educator, artist based in Minnesota, who is a survivor of COVID-19 and survived fruit of those collaborations between the University of Minnesota and Medic with Cuban specialists. Then we'll have Alisa Yarko, who wears many hats in Cuban solidarity and will speak as co-chair of the Nobel Peace Prize for Cuba committee. This next year will be the year for that as well. And then we'll see a video, Get Out of Cuba's Way campaign, where brilliant youth call for the end to the blockade so that a new world can be made possible. And that's, pardon all, that's my alarm. And then Allison and I will talk, we'll invite you all to discuss. So as she shared, people will be putting questions into the chat box throughout the presentation and also in the Q&A. And we will put those to the wonderful presenters who will be speaking this evening. And then we'll close and make a call to action. Now is the time. So to begin, I'll introduce Dr. Samir Adri. She's a 2020, very recent graduate of ELAM, and she is staff at IFCO Pastors for Peace as program coordinator of the really incredible and paralleled ELAM scholarship. And as you all may know, as those who believe in Cuban sovereignty, ELAM was established in 1999 after Hurricane Mitch and other disasters devastated Central America. And it was set up to train medical professionals from the region and has since graduated tens of thousands of physicians from working class communities across over 100 countries. And these doctors, medical practitioners, graduate without catastrophic debt and with a real spirit of solidarity and community healthcare, which we so desperately need at this time. And I actually met Dr. Adre in the Reverend Lucius Walker room at the MLK Center in Havana in December. When she and other students were speaking to a room full of delegates from the US as part of the Solidarity Collective, learning about the Cuban model. And she will be sharing a brief video. Dr. Adre.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Pambana, for that nice intro. It's an honor to be here tonight after a seven-year journey in Cuba. It's good to be back home. It is not good to be back home during this pandemic, but all the same, I am back and delighted to join the fight and serve. I'm going to speak to the Cuban response to COVID. This year, since I was there from the beginning of when we first
Hi, Samira, I think your internet might have frozen. This is our internet age, as everyone knows. So Samira, if you maybe want to come back without the video, we might be able to hear you better.
Okay, no problem. Okay. Hopefully it stays now. So as I was saying, I was in Havana, Cuba from the very first day the first cases of COVID were reported and left Cuba on August 26th. Just to give a background of what Cuba's role has been in terms of healthcare, because I'm sure the audience is mixed, some of us veterans to that reputation and others who are not very much aware yet. So the truth is that Cuba, since the onset of the revolution, rededicated its cause to uplifting the Cuban people by ensuring certain basic rights. One of those key rights being the right to health. And it was paramount to Its success, one thing that was paramount to its success was that Cuba had always paid attention to what the decisions that had been made internationally. One of those key decisions or declarations being the Alma-Ata Declaration of 1978, where it was established and underscored the importance of primary health care as a right to establishing health for all. So in 1978, by then, Cuba had already started training thousands of its young people to become medical doctors, and then had already established what would be one of the defining factors in its success as a healthcare structure, which was the importance of the community polyclinic as the heart of that work that you do as a primary care specialist. And so later on in the 80s, aside from the polyclinic becoming important to this healthcare structure, the family physician and nurse were the key components that became those satellite entities that would contribute to the success of the community polyclinic. Why do I mention these things? Because without the family physician and the family nurse, the Cuban government could not keep a pulse on the state of health of their nation. These family nurses and physicians were responsible for assessing the state of health of their communities on an annual basis, getting to know their patients constantly in order to know what the prevalent problems were in or are in their communities. And then based on those problems, creating solutions along with the communities, not just from a top-down fashion. These family physicians and nurses, the approach would be to sit down with these communities after highlighting the problems to assess how they could approach solutions together. Because we know one of the biggest issues is creating a solution or a treatment for a patient without keeping in mind what is within the possibilities of the patient makes it impossible for people to follow treatment plans or just their health. But more importantly, the approach or the focus of Cuba has always been preventative. And so these family doctors and nurses have been the pillars in keeping the population abreast and educated about their health and the problems that contribute to disease. So needless to say, that has been the groundwork that has been in place in Cuba for many years now and has led to what we know as the impressive positive health indicators that Cuba is known for. Its low infant mortality, which currently stands at 4 for every 1,000 live births, 99% vaccination for the entire population, and so many other things. And all this being under a criminal blockade. So needless to say, Cuba has been in this game, keeping health as an important aspect of keeping society healthy for a long time. And so when this pandemic hit, it was no different. In January of 2020, Cuba already had a prevention and control plan for the pandemic. And this plan outlined how all of the workforce would be educated, not only healthcare, but in other sectors, especially tourism, in order to educate the population. And also, this plan also outlined what would be done, how everybody would be mobilized in order to combat this pandemic. So when the first cases were called out on, confirmed in March 11th, when the first three cases were confirmed, Cuba went to work. That's just what happened. The first thing was they enacted the National Active Pesquisa. This pesquisa is a community health survey that's usually done, not just for COVID, but has been done periodically, annually, to combat other diseases such as dengue, which is endemic to Cuba. And so we had experience with doing these community health surveys. And the video that we're going to show later is displaying how US alum students were part of the student body. All medical students were called upon to go door to door and seek out patients that may have symptoms, find out who they had been in contact with in order to control this disease. So that was one thing. But what I wanted to share before you see that video, which will give you more detail about what exactly happened with the pesquisa, what I wanted to share was that Cuba's approach to this pandemic has been, for me, what I call the three T's: timely, transparent, and transformative. Timely because Cuba's response to the new coronavirus threat was quick. Like I said, they had a plan already in January 2020. And when the cases came on, they just took off. And I've explained the timeline for how the disease progressed. But after these cases started surging, we also saw that different other sectors were involved in creating solutions, but I'll get to that. The other T is transparent because the population was publicly informed on all measures being taken. The concerns of the public were publicly debated on national television and solutions proposed on those same platforms. The key here being that the Ministry of Health was entrusted to lead the fight and address the nation on the state of the situation. Daily reports were given by the National Director of Epidemiology, Dr. Francisco Duran Garcia, and he would give updated statistics on confirmed cases, deaths reported, and recoveries, which to date, Cuba boasts 90% recovery rate for COVID cases. He would also talk about how many cases were stable, how many were critical, and who were in grave conditions. And all this information I'm saying was given in detail. And you can find this information on the Ministry of Health's website from day one until now, where they give you a clinical vignette of each case that is critical, which is something that's pretty much unheard of this side of the world. But it's phenomenal to have witnessed that. Aside from that, he would, aside from relaying those hard facts, he would give general information about COVID-19 to the public, constantly, educating and re-educating the masses about the nature of the virus and its signs and symptoms, as well as answering questions and concerns from the public. He would speak on the protocols being followed in Cuba and then draw in information received via teleconferences held with international counterparts. Cuba utilized its state-run media to really educate the public about what was going on with the battle against COVID. A key example was how they use the new show La Mesa Redonda. Basically 2-hour daily conversations with national leaders and authorities, giving us detailed answers to people's concerns and questions. And on several occasions, the president, Miguel Díaz-Canel, was present to have frank discussions with the general population. I saw the director of the Institute of Tropical Disease, Dr. Lupe Guzman, come on and teach the public about what COVID was all about, the history of viruses in general, and then more particularly how this virus differed from other viruses like H1N1 and the old SARS virus, which was identified in 2003. These are things that I don't know how to express to you, but for me, seeing that on a public level was super impressive. And later on, we would down the line would see the leadership team behind the search for the COVID vaccine at the Finlay Institute also come on to TV and teach the masses about what the whole process of finding and identifying a vaccine looks like and how much time it takes and the elements that would be incorporated in that specific Cuban vaccine. So they didn't leave anything anybody in the dark about this situation or the fight and how everybody was involved in working 24/7 to ensure that Cuban people were safe. And not only Cuban people, the rest of the world, because Cuba never leaves its neighbors behind. That's just how it is. And so I see, I just want to express that you see here that there was an active campaign to maintain health literacy as a pillar in preventative healthcare, which is something, unfortunately, we do not understand yet in many parts of the world. Then the last T was, it was transformative because it showed the coverage of the convergence of disaster preparedness and health prevention measures, which Cuba is known for, and Cuba using its intersectorial approach. This health public health problem became not just contingent upon what the Ministry of Health would say or do, but rather what all sectors of society would contribute. So you had agriculture come in, you had commerce come in, you had travel and transportation, all involved, put together, everybody's activity was all reorganized in order to keep the population safe. And I could go on and on, but I want you to see some of the things that happen on the ground by the students, the medical students, in this case, the US medical students, when we were there. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samira Adri. We're gonna play a video now to help put into context some of that amazing presentation. I'm gonna go ahead and start the video for everyone.
Approach in the fight against COVID-19 starts off first and foremost with an emphasis on prevention, and that's preventing the virus from entering the country and then preventing the virus from entering certain neighborhoods. In areas where there are positive cases of COVID-19, the goal is to contain the virus, and all of this is done with the participation of sectors from every aspect of life, from doctors, from medical students, other healthcare workers, and more importantly, members of the community.
Well, Cuba's approach to fighting COVID-19 is a proactive one, which makes sense because the healthcare system is founded upon preventative medicine. When the pandemic really started to take shape, Cuba did a great job of preparing their citizens on what to expect from the coronavirus, what are the signs and symptoms, what do you do in the event that you get these signs and symptoms? You know, who is the at-risk population?
The Cuban system is vigilant in that medical professionals actively look for cases rather than waiting for patients to come to them. In Cuba, the pesquisaje is used as one of the first lines of defense in prevention. Cuban medical professionals visit all the houses in their assigned communities in order to check up on their community members. It is used as a tool in order to prevent and control the spread of certain diseases, as well as a tool to collect biostatistical data.
We go into the communities, to people's homes, to see how is their home environment, how is their house, how is the community itself and the hygiene of the community, as well as other issues.
It's really important to identify potential cases in the community. That's the main objective of the pesquisa. But it's also a great way to remind the community about preventative measures and actions to take to fight COVID-19.
We come here to the communities, we talk to upwards of 50 patients a day in their households, and we ask them who lives there, if there are any patients that are showing symptoms, if there's any patients that are over 60, which is considered a risk factor, and therefore we add those numbers up, and then we give them to the professor to then tabulate all this information and have it available for the people in the polyclinic to follow up on.
For me, I've been going to the same neighborhood, the same block, for maybe more than a month. So around now, I know the names and faces of like 60 plus homes, and they also know my face. But I don't go the next day, they ask me where have I been. For me, that's what community health looks like, is where you get to know your patients.
Before now, we have done pesquisa yearly for dengue during its peak times. I feel as though during pesquisa is my way of contributing to assist in saving lives as a future doctor in training.
When the first case was discovered later on in March, Cuba readily made available the resources necessary to isolate and treat confirmed cases, recognize and quarantine suspected individuals, and conduct tests to diagnose or rule out suspected cases. The preventative measures have been active and not passive. That is because the cases are sought out. Within communities with confirmed cases, there are mass screenings and testings conducted.
When you get tested, if your test comes back positive, you are going directly to the hospital. You were ingressed, and you are going to a specific hospital attending to all COVID-19 patients.
A couple of differences between the approach, the Cuban approach and the American approach to fighting COVID-19 is one that Cuba has a central and universal healthcare system, whereas in the United States of America, we do not have a universal healthcare system, where we do not have a healthcare system at all. And one of the advantages to that is that everybody on this island gets care irrespective of income, race, et cetera, or any other determining factors. If you are symptomatic, that is known to be a risk for the entire country, and therefore you receive treatment. So what you are hearing right now is the applause that every night at 9 p.m., Cuban people everywhere, all across the country, go out on their balconies, their windows, and show their appreciation for all the healthcare workers in the country who are really sacrificing and putting themselves and their families at risk to try to eradicate this virus on the island.
Cuba has shown its solidarity with the world by sending its physicians abroad to aid in the fight of this pandemic. Some of the countries that have benefited from this aid are China, Italy, Jamaica, Togo, Mexico, amongst many. Even the UK benefited from Cuba's aid when it accepted to receive and treat infected UK citizens.
Elam teaches you to be ready for anything, and Elam teaches you to go where you are sent, to go where the crisis is, to go where the need is.
It has also stressed the importance of having a plan, having preventative measures, and also the importance of having collaborators, both domestic and international. In this case, it is one world, one fight.
It is amazing to be a part of a nation right now that has a human-centered approach, not because it's new to this pandemic situation, but because that is the structure of the Cuban healthcare system, to value people, to value humans, and it's not a business.
This really puts places into perspective the importance of having a system in place for when the next crisis hits.
It's an honor to live and learn in this system. I hope our communities back home will learn from this example and actively seek out the health of present and future generations. And it is clear that as COVID-19 respects no color or creed, our health system and society in general must learn to value all human life, regardless of color.
Thank you so much for that beautiful video presentation and presentation, really rooting us in how another world is needed and possible. And we have clear examples that are both, you know, ethical, moral, as well as, you know, mechanical and technical, how we can respond to this kind of disaster with compassion and save lives. Dr. Samira, you said you wanted to just close with sharing some of your contact information, how folks can get in touch with you.
Yes, thank you all for giving us this slot on this important conference. Definitely want to say that this is just the beginning of what should be hopefully a short struggle. 2021 is the definitive year for this nonsense to end and for Cuba to come out to take its place, rightful place in the world stage, to be acknowledged for the work that it's doing and the way it has impacted so many lives, especially like my own and many other graduates of ELAM, the Latin American School of Medicine. And I'm giving a shout out to anybody who knows any youth who from 18, the ages of 18 to 35, US citizen, who would like to study medicine, please contact us at ifconews.org, go online and request an application. You can reach me directly at samira@ifconews.org. I will type it in the chat for everyone. And I'd be happy to entertain any questions you have about the Cuban response to COVID at the end when all the questions are compiled. Again, an honor and a privilege to be with you all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Adri. We now go to the US where Dr. Andy Coates is a physician in Albany, New York, in the country that spends the most money on healthcare and has a disastrous system. And Dr. Coates is one of the brilliant medical professionals who's been on the front lines, both treating patients who are suffering from COVID and also witnessing how the US healthcare system is bankrupting families, enriching corporations, and providing inefficient care. And he's among the many medical practitioners and professionals who are fighting for an alternative to keep for-profit out of healthcare and to ensure that health is about saving lives. So Dr. Coates, thank you so much for joining us. I'll pass the mic to you.
Thank you, Pombana. Upstate New York, I believe, is the Iroquois Five Nations region, specifically for us, the Mohawk. Let me just start in the biggest way. Rudolf Virchow was the great pioneer of pathology and social medicine in the 19th century. And he famously said that medicine is a social science and politics, nothing but medicine on a larger scale. The example that Cuba has set in medicine on a world stage is unparalleled. One of my favorite examples is that an article by the Canadian health policy giant, Bob Evans. There's a hypothesis put forward by Thomas McCune in the 1950s that doctors really don't matter, that the great revolution in mortality of the 19th and early 20th century had to do with sewers, stabilizing the food supply, housing, the general standard of living, and doctors hardly made any difference, drugs hardly made any difference. But Bob Evans' article is called Thomas McCune Meet Fidel Castro. And he points out that Cuba has more doctors per capita than any nation, that Cuba has sent doctors all over the world more than any international operation or national operation, and that the Cuban example has led to magnificent health outcomes. I would point, for example, to the shameful statistic in the United States that maternal mortality has gotten worse and worse for the last two decades, while in Cuba, and like the rest of the world, it's gotten better and better. Cuba's made great strides in life expectancy when the United States, for about the last decade, has failed to lower life expectancy. In fact, life is getting shorter, especially for the poor. In the COVID pandemic time, one of the things that's magnified, people like to talk about the 1% and the 99%, but it's not just that people have gotten so wealthy in the United States, it's that the poor have gotten so poor. And the contours of poverty, of course, have to do with the racist organization of our society. What this meant for me as a critical care hospitalist in April, as we got a deluge of patients transferred 120 miles away from their homes in Queens because of the crisis of the hospitals there, were African-American, Caribbean immigrant, Central American immigrant families separated from their loved ones on a ventilator in critical care. And guess what? Unlike Dr. Adrey, our medical students weren't mobilized. They all wanted to be mobilized. They were sent out. They were sent home. And so what we did was we organized mutual aid with the medical students. The medical students started babysitting for nurses that were working too much. The medical students came in and ran the iPad so that the patient's loved ones in Queens could see their loved ones in the ICU. And the medical students were incredibly energetic, but it was all volunteerism. There was no planning whatsoever. And it was a very poignant human experience. I think Dr. Adrey just gave us a glimpse of what it means to amplify what's happened in Cuba in 2020 to our communities. I think there's a great future to be had in dialogue with our colleagues in Cuba, doctor to doctor, student to student, to help amplify the experiences that we've just heard about. But Cuba really just did what works, following the science. What is it that can stop a pandemic? Testing, tracing, and quarantine. Ideas that are literally 1,000 years old, that really got going in the 1300s with the first organized quarantines, and that have been deployed and perfected through the influenza pandemic all the way to the George W. Bush administration here in the United States, which recommended school closings because they figured out that if influenza came to a town of 10,000 and the schools were closed, it would spread to 500 people. But if the schools were open, it would spread to 5,000. That was what the science said. And so that's what the George W. Bush administration recommended. Dr. Adrey tells us of a completely different counterexample. And so now Cuba has developed drugs. Itolizumab is now FDA approved for study in the United States, and it's been used in India, it's been used in Cuba. There's a small, very promising study in Cuba from a nursing home. There's a homeopathic, forgive my pronunciation, but Vengovir, which has been distributed and tried, and the interferon alpha-2b, which is an old antiviral that Cuba pioneered and perfected, all very promising. And now two vaccines, Sovereign 1 and Sovereign 2, already in trials from Cuba, and two more vaccines on the way, all from a country that spends less than 1/10 per person of what the United States spends on healthcare. And so this example needs to be amplified and shared. And of course, the shameful blockade must come to an end because it is an absolute crime. The United States has attacked and underfunded and defunded public health over the last decade, starting from Obama all the way through Trump, all the way until defunding the World Health Organization, which I would point out the Lancet journal called A Crime Against Humanity. So at this time, we can learn much from Cuba about the fight for health justice, a fight against racism and homophobia, and the incredible example of the contributions doctors can make to our fellow human beings. Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
Thank you very much, Dr. Andy Coates. I think you brought up a very important point of what a critical moment we are in with the criminal negligence of the US government, especially when it comes to the COVID-19 pandemic, and increasing numbers here in Canada that impact marginalized Black and Brown people and Indigenous people the most. Now more than ever, we must talk about looking towards Cuba and Cuba's example for moving forward and really recognizing what it could mean to have free, accessible healthcare that put people above profit. I wanted to just take a quick second to make a shout out to our Cuban friends that are watching this webinar on Facebook. It is not possible for them to participate over Zoom due to the US blockade, but there are especially people giving their support from Cuba from the Cuban Institute of Friendship with the Peoples, ECAP, which this year is celebrating their 60th year and has been a tremendous partner in building Cuba's solidarity and fighting for an end to the criminal blockade. Now, in this session where we're learning so much about Cuba's example and the importance of continuing our fight against the coronavirus pandemic. We want to welcome up an expert on this subject, someone who has done tremendous work from Canada, but around the world, in really elevating how much the world knows about Cuba's international medical missions and their example. John Kirk is a professor of Latin American studies at Dalhousie University in Halifax, Canada. He is an expert on the history of the country's humanitarian efforts and its medical internationalism, who, among other experiences, had the opportunity to be embedded with and observe Cuba's Henry Reeve Medical Emergency Brigade in El Salvador 10 years ago after that country was hit by a hurricane. Please join me in welcoming Dr. John Kirk.
Hi, folks. Welcome from Halifax, Nova Scotia. This is unceded territory. This is Mi'kma'ki, unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq. I've been going to Cuba since 1976 when I was a young graduate student. In the last 15 years, I've been looking at Cuba's role in medical internationalism, following Cuban medical personnel to a variety of countries. And in the 10 minutes that I have, I wanted to speak very briefly about two things. First of all, I'd like to continue the two previous speakers with their marvelous presentations, some observations as to why Cuba has been successful with COVID and some lessons learned, some of which are applicable to us in Canada and I think in the United States. And secondly, to speak about Cuba's COVID mission in the 39 countries where they have been since March. I'd like to begin just throwing out some stats. I went on the Johns Hopkins site today. Florida's got about twice the population of Cuba. Cuba's population is 11.2 million. The number of cases in Florida is 875,096. Cuba's is 7,568. The number of deaths in Florida today is 17,489. In Cuba, 131. So basically, people in Florida are about 60 times more likely to become infected and to die of COVID than they are in Cuba. Cuba, a country which puts people before profits. And a few things that it's done well, and I'd like to follow on from what Samira said, because I think her observations were very appropriate. Why has Cuba done so well? Well, first of all, as an island, it's easier to close down. But what is significant, they stopped tourism, the second major source of cash from the very beginning. Health trumped, no pun intended, money. So public health before profits. Secondly, the philosophy, and I think that Samir mentioned this very, very clearly, prevention. Prevention is far cheaper than cure. The drug companies don't like it because that's not how they make money, but prevention is the way to go. And Samir gave an excellent presentation as to what exactly the Cubans did. Cuba's got the highest ratio of doctor to patient in the world, 8.2 per thousand versus 2.6 in the United States. So Cuba's got three times as many doctors per capita as the United States, and they use them well in a system that is free to all and accessible to all, concepts which would be very strange in the United States. And the role of the family doctor is crucially, and the nurse, crucially important. The fact that 28,000 medical students, nursing students, went out door to door with the pesquisaje, I think is extremely important. Today, there were 8,094 tests in Cuba. The Cuban government is totally on top of it. The contact tracing, which was mentioned by Dr. Coates, also using the mass organizations, the Cubans have been able to trace. And also one of the things which I found very strange at first, but makes perfect sense, that the quarantine of people suspected of having the virus in their contacts, 115,000 people have been put in isolation centers, have been quarantined, precisely because it's important to make sure that you stop this in its track. And of course, the fact that Cuba produces 60% of its own medicines, and Soberana 1 and 2, as we mentioned, by Dr. Coates, I think is important. So again, people versus profits. What I want to speak now, the second thing I want to speak about in the time allotted is what Cuba has done abroad. So not only has it done a remarkable job, again, people are 1/60th as likely to get infected in Cuba as they are in Florida. And this is after adjusting for the per capita. So the, so I sat down with the calculator and the figures are more or less, I think, okay. The Henry Reeve Brigade, which has sent medical personnel to 39 countries, 53 missions altogether, and almost 4,000 doctors, nurses, and technicians. People don't really understand that what they've been doing this since 2005. In 2005, when Hurricane Katrina devastated New Orleans, Cuba offered to send 1,400 physicians to assist the population. The George W. Bush administration preferred to play politics rather than save lives and didn't even recognize. So you've got 1,400 doctors and nurses, wait specialists in emergency medicine, waiting to go in Havana with their backpacks ready, and the US government refused to even accept them. That was in 2005. Since then, the Cubans have been sending, the Henry Reeve Brigade have been sending medical missions all over the place. In Pakistan, shortly afterwards, October 2005, 2,000 Cuban medics went after a devastating earthquake in Pakistan. People may remember in Haiti in 2010, massive earthquake followed by an outbreak of cholera. The Cubans already had 400 physicians there, had already been training 700 Haitians in Santiago and sent more physicians, including many Elamistas who went to help in Haiti. They saved 76,000 lives. Ebola, 2014, many people remember this because it's not that long ago, it's just 6 years ago. WHO appealed for assistance to from around the world. The very first country to respond was Cuba. 5,000 Cubans volunteered to go to the three West African countries most affected. In the end, Cuba selected 256, and they were there for several months, providing us medical assistance to 400,000 Africans. So now we get to the most current stage and the fight against COVID. Cuba accepted requests from 39 countries, almost 4,000 medical personnel, of whom 61% were women, which I think is worthwhile pointing out. 53 missions, so several went to, or some of them went to several countries, Italy being one of the first and the best examples, in Latin America, the Caribbean, Asia, Africa, Oceania, Middle East, and Europe. Extraordinary. So not only were the Cubans doing far better than any industrialized country in dealing with COVID on their own territory, but also this small country, this developing country of just 11 million people also sent almost 4,000 of its medics. Now, it's worthwhile bearing in mind that when they went, there were already, i.e., the day before COVID was discovered, there were 28,500 Cuban doctors, nurses, and technicians who were working already in 58 countries, mainly in sub-Saharan Africa. But they were already there. Cuba, in addition to that, sent, as I say, almost 4,000. So the medical care has been provided to 4 million people, saved the lives of over 90,000. And I think it's significant to bear in mind that this is an extraordinary example of humanitarian solidarity. This is more than all of the G7 countries, the so-called developed countries, combined. It is extraordinary. And as a Canadian, I'm embarrassed to see just how poorly we do. We have not allowed Cuban doctors to come to deal with First Nations in Manitoba, even though the chiefs of those nations requested them. So to conclude, I would say that this is the greatest story never told. It is a story which our media deliberately ignore, and it is one which has saved untold lives. It's a story which we all need to know about, and it's great to be part of this webinar and to learn from people, and also to be able to explain how the current situation in COVID and what the Cubans are doing fits in with the broader picture. They get it. They get the broad picture. Muchas gracias a todos.
Muchas gracias, John. That was way on time. So thank you so much. And this concludes kind of the first part of our session tonight. This is the part of informing each other about Cuba's incredible example, and also making sure that we understand the level, and I think we all do, the level of the crisis that is being faced within the United States and Canada when confronting coronavirus. And we all unfortunately know that this won't be the last time that a virus or a crisis hits the United States and Canada. And we all have to work for more people-to-people cooperation, especially when it comes to working with Cuba and fighting against the US blockade. So now we're gonna move into our second session of this evening, where we will discuss the actions that people can take to end the criminal US blockade on Cuba through promoting the Saving Lives campaign for US-Cuba-Canada medical cooperation. This campaign has brought together people from the United States, Canada, and Quebec who've been working to develop medical cooperation between the countries, working towards the passing of city council or labor council and statewide resolutions promoting this cooperation, developing media strategy for raising awareness about Cuba's leading role in the fight against the pandemic in mainstream and local media, and also working on really talking directly to doctors and even the pharmaceutical companies that exist in the United States about the nuts and bolts of how Cuban medicines could be used in the United States. As we know, Cuba's biotechnical industry has developed many medicines that could be used by people in the United States, including groundbreaking treatments for diabetes and for lung cancer. So within the Saving Lives campaign, which we'll post information about in the chat, the campaign specifically calls for allowing US, Cuba, Canada medical, clinical, and scientific collaboration, including inviting Cuban medical brigades to provide direct medical assistance and or to provide advice and guidance in treating COVID-19. Two, incorporating Cuba's interferon alpha-2b recombinant in clinical trials in the United States and Canada and through the World Health Organization, as well as granting by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration approval for Cuba's interferon alpha-2b recombinant. And three, ending U.S. economic and travel sanctions against Cuba, including its extraterritorial nature and the attempts to stop all other countries from accepting Cuban medical brigades and assistance, and all ongoing measures that prevent Cuba from accessing and importing medical equipment and medicines to confront COVID-19. So this is the work of the campaign. Again, we'll post in the chat, and now we will open up the section of tonight's webinar where we're going to learn more about what the Saving Lives campaign has been doing and how people can get involved in this important work. So I want to ask Pombana if she could please introduce this part.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for those brilliant presentations that really lay out how much we have to gain from ending the blockade. And just make one question, what would be possible if Cuba did not have this blockade, this criminal blockade costing them billions and billions and preventing us from exchange? You know, what would be possible? And so with the Saving Lives campaign, we're focusing on that, that lives would be saved, and doing some really concrete actions to show that really the tide has turned, that there's incredible solidarity with Cuba and a deep desire for this blockade to be lifted. So one of those is passing local resolutions. And the team has created just really beautiful videos that we will link to in the chat box. And Rita actually introduces these two videos in the video, and hopefully we'll turn on her video. Oh, her video's on, greetings. And share with us how we can pass these resolutions by communities, cities, unions. And she will read them along with organizers who are part of making that possible, and offer a kind of step-by-step for how you can do this work as well. So Allison, if you could share the group video, and then I'll pass the mic on to you, Rita, to introduce the tips.
Greetings. This is a resolution to support medical and scientific collaboration between our city or state or labor union and Cuba to address the COVID-19 pandemic. It urges the U.S. Congress to permit collaboration by suspending economic and travel sanctions against Cuba. Everyone in this video has been involved with passing resolutions. We invite you to join us.
Whereas the United States has the highest number of COVID-19 cases and deaths in the world, 9.39 million infected, with deaths of over 232,000. Whereas Cuba, with a population of over 11 million, has had a total of 7,184 cases and only 129 deaths.
Whereas in the US, the death fall disproportionately on Black, Latinx, and Indigenous communities, elders and workers, especially those deemed essential, and their families. Whereas, in the face of this worldwide menace, now is the time for international collaboration and solidarity.
Whereas our community is home to prestigious medical institutions which could provide leadership in medical research, treatment, and cooperation. Whereas under the banner of healthcare as a human right, Cuban medical personnel in the Henry Reeve International Medical Brigade against disasters and epidemics treat people fighting COVID-19. Whereas 50 countries have requested aid from the brigade, with over 3,700 Cuban workers currently serving in the battle against COVID-19 in more than 39 countries.
Whereas Cuba offers treatment regimens and immune boosters for patients, plus prevention protocols for health workers, the US has had approximately 1,700 health worker deaths, while within Cuba, not one single health worker has died after being infected by a patient with COVID-19. Whereas more than 42 countries want to acquire the immune booster alpha-2B recombinant to include in treatment of COVID-19.
Whereas this medication is unavailable in the United States due to the 60-year-old U.S. blockade against Cuba, which severely restricts collaborations of scientific and medical research and treatment, and which interferes in saving lives in this pandemic. Whereas worldwide, sadly, 80% of COVID-19 patients in critical condition are dying. And by contrast, in Cuba, 80% of patients in critical condition are now being saved due to the new treatments developed in Cuba.
Whereas resolutions for collaborations with Cuba have been introduced or passed in cities including San Francisco, Oakland, Richmond, and Berkeley, California, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Chicago, Illinois. States including Minnesota and labor unions, including the Washington State Labor Council, MLK Labor Council, and Sacramento Central Labor Council, with many more resolutions in the pipeline. Whereas medical collaborations have been successful between Cuba's Center for Molecular Immunology and Buffalo, New York's Roswell Park Comprehensive Center for Cancer regarding the Cuban lung cancer vaccine Simavax. Also, successful collaboration between Cuba and the University of Chicago, Illinois regarding infant mortality.
Whereas in 2015, the World Health Organization recognized Cuba as a worldwide leader in biotechnology for its significant contributions, such as the treatment that prevents 77% of diabetic amputations, whereas people in the United States would benefit from Cuban biotechnical, medical, and public health expertise in combating the COVID-19 pandemic, including the development of two vaccines, Soberana 1 and Soberana 2, Sovereign 1 and Sovereign 2 in clinical trials.
Now, therefore, be it resolved that our community explore collaborations with Cuba to fight the COVID-19 pandemic, including Cuba's highly successful public health strategies, prevention strategies, such as preventing infections of health workers, innovative treatments, and vaccines.
Be it further resolved that our community supports the lifting of restrictions on the Cuban COVID-19 treatment, interferon alpha 2 be recombinant, opening a path for interclinical trials.
Be it further resolved that our community urges the U.S. Congress and the President suspend U.S. economic and travel sanctions against Cuba and to lift restrictions on access to Cuban medical expertise and treatments in order to more effectively combat the COVID-19 pandemic. Be it further resolved that our community calls on the federal government to cease ongoing measures that deter Cuba from importing medical equipment and medicines to confront COVID-19, and to cease all attempts to stop other countries from accepting Cuban medical brigades.
Join all of us in passing resolutions wherever you live for health and solidarity, por la salud y la solidaridad de los pueblos. Thank you.
Rita, I believe you were going to say a few words.
Thank you. I'm speaking to you from Richmond, California on occupied Ohlone land. And I'm really proud to be part of this collaboration. It's particularly exciting to have a very concrete strategy that we can all be accomplishing. It's gratifying to pass these resolutions and it's really doable. Everyone who's initiated them has been succeeding. We now want to ask everyone who's watching to consider where you can pass a resolution. And we're going to make it quite easy for you. We have compiled a list of tips that assisted us in different locations. It's a combination of our successes in San Francisco, Richmond, and Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Minnesota. And in one handy sheet, you can have the key tips from the organizers in all those places available to you by link on your chat. We want to ask you to click on the link to, it just says tips, and it's a bit link, tips, and also the link is another link that is to our model resolution. What you just heard us present, recite, our choral group, that is also in writing in the chat available to you. And it's fairly simple to adapt it to your municipality, your city, your labor union, your state, board of supervisors. Just think about where you know elected officials who would be supportive. It's great to do it from an educational standpoint. And every resolution is a building block that adds pressure towards ending this absurd embargo. So we have created a very brief video explaining these tips to you, and we're going to watch it now. Thank you. These are tips for passing a resolution. Organizers from across the US who have already passed them want to share these winning strategies with you. We encourage you to initiate a resolution to educate and expand support for medical and scientific collaboration with Cuba. First, reflect on your city, county board, state legislature, or labor union, and decide where you want your resolution to be passed. Form an organizing committee in your community. Then gather some resources, data, to support your resolution. On the Saving Lives website, you'll find sample resolutions from other communities, articles about Cuba and healthcare in comparison to the US. You'll need to identify a sponsor or an author for your resolution, someone who has a commitment to solidarity with Cuba. Think about choosing your own state rep or city council person, since they are likely to want to work with you. Then you can draft a proposed resolution or adapt ours and collaborate with the sponsor to make any changes that would strengthen it. You want to develop a lobbying plan with your organizing committee to promote your resolution. You can build relationships with the elected or union officials who will consider and vote on your resolution. It's best to meet with them to explain it, the rationale behind it, and what can be achieved. It's important to have a one-page summary for your pitch and lobbying. It's a good idea to identify some prominent grassroots local allies in support. Get to know someone with experience in lobbying who can advise you on the process for getting your resolution passed. Members of our Saving Lives campaign can also be a good resource for you. Please contact us. Broad-based community support for the resolution is important. Ask advocates to contact officials before a vote is taken. Make sure to inform the media about the resolution vote as well. Passing resolutions calling for medical and scientific collaboration with Cuba are powerful tools. They're building increased support in US municipalities and states and labor unions for normalizing relations between Cuba and the US. We can do this. Join us. Thank you.
Thank you so much for those great videos. We put the links into the chat box, and please, please, if you're interested or you know of any people or organizations who might be interested in working on a resolution, fill out the really simple Google form that's in the chat box, and we'll keep loading it. And thank you to the Resolutions Committee. To Rita, is it Baruch? Rita Baruch, and apologies for not introducing you formally. Richmond, California, Regla, Cuba Friendship Committee and co-author of the San Francisco Bay Area Resolutions for U.S.-Cuba Cooperation. So the folks who we saw in those videos were all part of doing this work, and we with the Saving Lives campaign are incredibly motivated and mobilized to support you in passing resolutions. I saw in the chat group an applause given for the committee for moving the needle. And really, that's what we need to do, is just create what Isaac Saini said earlier today, a critical mass of resolutions to show what is the dignified and just position of the people. During the question and answers section at the end of this webinar, Rita Marcy Shapiro in Minnesota and Nancy Yamata in Sacramento, which just fabulously passed a resolution. I believe it's the largest city in the country. They will be available to respond to questions, and all three of them have led in this incredible process. So please put your questions into the chat box. And now I will pass over the mic to Allison on medical collaboration, unless Rita, you'd like to say some closing words.
Just that, you know, this is such an important collaborative effort, and we'd like to hear about at least 15 more resolutions that people want to initiate out of today's work. Thank you.
Excellent, it's true. Thank you very much, Rita, and to the entire committee that's been working on resolutions really across the United States. Also, thank you to Pombana for leading that section. Next, we're gonna talk about medical collaboration. The committee that's been working on medical collaboration, there's going to be two speakers to address this. One will be Dr. John Oswald and another Nachito Herrera. But to start this off, I'm just going to read a brief statement about the work they've been doing and how the campaign has been going and how you can get involved. From the Medical Collaboration Committee of the Saving Lives Campaign. First, we want to encourage other cities to consider organizing public health forums, building on the University of Minnesota Medic collaboration that Dr. John Oswald described, or will describe in a few minutes. The Saving Lives campaign is prepared to sponsor and help organize these activities, hopefully with input from Medic. Several cities believe have the ability to organize these forums. Seattle, the San Francisco Bay Area, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Secondly, Dr. Andy Coates, who we heard speak earlier, has agreed to help coordinate a forum between the US and Cuban medical students to discuss the pandemic, the medical profession, and the future of our planet. Andy already has some medical students in the Albany, New York area, but we want to connect with medical students in other cities. It would be very helpful if others participating in this webinar could help build this effort. Contact the Saving Lives campaign and we'll put folks in the medical committee in contact with you. I'll post those links very shortly. Finally, a Biden presidency will, with our organizing, lead to a rollback in the travel restrictions and visa regulations to the pre-Trump period. The Saving Lives campaign would like to move quickly to reestablish and deepen medical and scientific ties between our countries. Some examples of previous collaborations during the Obama period included a partnership between the Roswell Park Cancer Center and the Center for Molecular Immunology to develop a drug that could treat lung cancer. The University of Illinois and the Cuban Ministry of Public Health teamed up to bring Cuban doctors to Chicago to improve maternal health and birth outcomes to patients in their homes. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services signed a historic memorandum of understanding with Cuba's Ministry of Public Health to collaborate on a broad range of public health issues, including global health security, communicable and non-communicable diseases, research and development, and information technology, and dozens of world-class surgeons from hospitals and universities across the United States, including Stanford University Medical Center, Texas Children's Hospital, and USC, traveled to Cuba to train their counterparts in advanced surgical techniques. We'd like participants on this webinar to think creatively about similar collaborations they'd like to help organize to build a strong and lasting medical and scientific bridges between the United States, Canada, and Cuba. So again, that's a message from the medical committee. And now we have two extraordinary speakers. The first of which is Dr. John Oswald, who is speaking from the University of Minnesota Medic Collaboration. Please join me in welcoming John.
Hi, thank you very much. It's a great privilege to speak with you all tonight. And I'm, as said, from the University of Minnesota, and also it's really exciting that Nachito Herrera is also here tonight and can talk about his experience as a COVID patient at the University of Minnesota Medical Center. And I'll be speaking about our research planning and collaborations that we're planning with Cuba. Oh, and I should also say that Minnesota is in part of the country that is unceded territory of the Lakota and the Ojibwa nations. So basically, with the, you know, with the onset of the coronavirus earlier this year, you know, there was a major effort within our university to coordinate efforts for medical research and all the other various aspects of health education, health statistics, all of the different disciplines within health sciences and public health to create a more effective presence and participation in the national efforts with COVID-19. But also for some of us who've been working with Cuba over the years and some of the great examples that you've given in Roswell and New York State and my more direct experience with the University of Illinois program in Chicago, that there have been some great examples over the past several years of collaboration. But how do we channel those kinds of experiences into something that's effective and hopefully creates a very tangible contribution to a variety of efforts that are going on with the coronavirus? And so that's where we really were drawn to reaching out to MEDIC. And I know that most of you are familiar with MEDIC. But for those of you who aren't, it's an organization that's been in operation for over 20 years. Its roots are in supporting the development of ELAM in a medical center, in medical school, I should say, in Havana. They also produce the MEDIC Review, which is a peer-reviewed journal of Cuban scientists, U.S. scientists, but also from other countries as well. And being a peer-reviewed health sciences journal with a solid track record of high quality research, that it provides a great sort of building block infrastructure for collaborative research that is of high quality. And so we reached out to MEDIC, and the executive director is Gail Reed. And again, I'm sure many of you know Gail or have met her, heard her speak. But she represents kind of a unique individual with credibility, certainly in Cuba and throughout a wide range of professional circles in the health sciences in the United States. And so Dr. Reed, Gail Reed, is going to facilitate for us a process of identifying priorities of joint opportunity. We're certainly looking at how we can support efforts in treatment related clinical trials, also vaccine related trials. And conversely, you know, where it makes sense, opportunities for Cuban researchers to participate in research going on at the University of Minnesota. As far as our kind of initial step is just even just the basic mechanics of setting up a first meeting. And so just one thing, you know, just is the real world of we had a tentative meeting plan in early November, but with the outbreaks, although relatively small outbreaks, but nonetheless important ones in several neighborhoods in Havana, and then especially in Ciego de Avila in the interior of the island, that we need to reschedule. And so now we're trying to see if we can set up our first meeting in December. And as far as the exact format, we're still working on that as well. We hope for it to represent from Cuba, people, leaders in the National Ministry of Public Health, the Tropical Medicine Institute, and the Finlay Institute for Vaccine Research. But again, you know, trying to finalize that in terms of availability and participation. And then finally, there's the issue of just our telecommunications platform. And some references have been made today about, you know, the challenges with Zoom. in Cuba. And so we're trying to be creative and kind of think outside the box of how we can work out the logistics of the communications for this. But I guess, you know, what I've shared with people on the Saving Lives Medical Committee is that we'll be glad to share with you, you know, kind of each step along the way of progress that we make, opportunities we identify, lessons learned, and just, you know, appreciate, you know, the opportunity to work collaboratively with colleagues in Cuba. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, sharing some real specific ideas, experiences, projects in the works to advance medical cooperation and collaboration with Cuba. Really, Medic has been key in promoting U.S.-Cuba health collaboration and really in highlighting Cuba's public health approaches and a very kind of technical, as well as health equity and public health and universal health based perspective. So thank you for that presentation, Dr. John Oswald. Next we have Nachito Herrera, who is just an incredibly accomplished artist and musician and educator. He has a PhD in music piano and orchestra conductor. He's a teacher in classical and jazz music, and one of the 17 patients in the world of COVID who survived using ECMO or ECMO in collaboration with the University of Minnesota Hospital and specialists from Cuba. So he really is one example of the possibilities of cooperation. Herrera is also the first Cuban American to receive from Ally National Immigration the Best Immigrant of the Year, and is the first Cuban American to have in Minnesota named for him a day that was signed by the governor for his contributions to education, diversity, and art. So Nachito Herrera, I will pass the mic to you, and we're so happy that you're with us, and give thanks to the team who is part of making that happen.
Hi, how are you? Let me check. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you very well and are very excited to hear your presentation, and you're looking healthy and well.
Yeah, thank you so much. And before I definitely want to say thanks so much to you and to all the people who are making this webinar, to inviting me. You know, it is a pleasure and an honor. And thanks so much for the big support that you all have been doing to my country. So, as you already mentioned, thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. I don't think I deserve that much, but well, yes, I am originally from Cuba. I graduated at the Superior Institute of Art in Havana, Cuba, in piano and orchestra conductor, and well, in 2001, I started to develop a contract here in Minnesota, which I have been staying for almost 20 years already. And starting right to the point, back in March 28th, I kind of in the morning, I present some kind of little symptoms like a stomach heat and kind of like a headache. And my wife decided to actually bring me to the hospital, to the St. John Hospital here, that's close to the city. I live in the city of Wiper Lake. So my wife and my daughter brought me to the hospital of St. John, the city of Maplewood. Why? Because, believe it or not, in the morning of March 28th, I was completely disorientated. I didn't even know if I was in my living room. I want to go to my bathroom, and I didn't even know where I was. So that was kind of like the symptoms. I started to get like a really, like we said, in a kind of like a bad shape. So once I get there, the doctors admit me at the hospital in St. John, and they check my oxygen. And believe it or not, I was just in a 35% of oxygen, according to what they said. The doctor said, like, even I was able to talk to him, and I can't remember anything about it. So right there, they proceed to intubate me, but my wife said right after 2-3 hours, the doctor came and I said, you know, we need to move him from here. I already contacted a wonderful team of specialists at a hospital at the University of Minnesota, and we are ready to move him because if we don't do it, barely, he will have 3 hours of life. So I can tell you how bad condition I was. So in the evening of the 28th, finally, after they worked really hard to stabilize myself, to being able to move from Maplewood to Minneapolis, which is about 25 minutes. Finally, I get to the hospital in the University of Minnesota, which is a wonderful doctors, wonderful team of specialists, the doctors and nurses, welcome me, come on. And then including Melissa Granswold. So Melissa Granswold is actually the director of the ECMO program in Minnesota, which was a really great coincidence to saying it in that way. Melissa just back 3 days before I get admitted at the hospital in Minnesota from Cuba, because she was at a convention there with different doctors. So right when they check, after 2-3 hours, they contact my wife. And they say, well, we had to work really hard. All his organs are failure. So when Melissa started work on connecting me to the ECMO machine, my heart started to failure. So they need to go and do another incision through my right leg to connect me through the bypass because my heart started to failure. Right after when they have that kind of in control, they say even my kidneys started to failure too. So they even start to make the evaluation or connect me to hemodialysis. But thankfully, my kidneys start to react better, and I didn't need to do that. So when they proceed and do the first COVID-19 test, obviously I became way positive. So all I am telling you is what I know after I wake up, because I was, since March 28th, I get in completely coma for 2 weeks. That was a period of 14 days. I was in completely coma. I can't remember anything. And when my wife started to get those kind of communications in terms of how bad my health started to be, actually she contact Mr. Jose Ramon Cabañas, with which, as you know, it is our Cuban ambassador in Washington, D.C. Thanks to him and his attorney and all his team there, they were able to contact Dr. Tania Crombet in Cuba, which is one of the most wonderful epidemiologists that we have there. And with Tania and his team in Cuba and his team at the doctors at the University of Minnesota, they start to establish a collaboration just to know what Cuba was doing in that time in terms of prevention plans and actually what type of medicaments they already start to kind of make some kind of experiments to try to prevent and stop the COVID. So that was a wonderful collaboration they did. And I think that we need to continue to work hard in terms of continue to promote those kind of collaboration, because it is so much advantage we can take these two countries, Cuba and United States. So that after 14 days, when I wake up and I, believe me, I thought it was kind of a joke, because I can't even remember when I get to the hospital of University of Minnesota and I saw myself completely connected, to those cables and tubes and and things like that. So doctors start to come and start to explain me what they did and the whole process. And definitely I wanna say, you know, thanks so much to these wonderful people, to our ambassador of Mr. Jose Ramon Cabañas and his whole team, actually to the old people, our diplomatic people, to the Cuban Embassy of United Nations in New York. And thanks so much to my dear friend, Tania Grumbate, and the whole doctors there in Cuba. Thanks to all of them. Here I am again, almost completely recovered, back to play my piano, which you can see we are in my studio. I am happy to show to you, and hopefully, you know, the next time I can play my music for all of you. And that is exactly why I want to continue to work with all of you to end the blockade, to end the embargo, because it hasn't been making sense for the last 6 decades. I don't think it is going to make sense, never. So this is something we need to continue to work, because as I said, not just on the health, but in the music, in the arts, in the health, and so many different areas, it is so much enrichment we can get, so much great collaboration we can get in between these two wonderful country, where my wife and I are part of the group, together with Dr. Oswald and another specialist here, which we are working with our governor, Mr. Tim Wallace, to finalize the digital tools, or like the resolution to also being able to bring the Cuban doctors from Cuba to Minnesota. I wanna definitely thanks to all of you for having me. Here is your friend, Nachiro Herrera, almost recovery, because one thing, the collaboration in between wonderful specialists from the United States and wonderful specialists from Cuba. So this is the result to work together. And I think it is definitely a time to continue to get united and get together and let the world know, like, just together is the only way we are gonna be able to win the war battles. Thank you so much for inviting me. God bless you all. I hope to see you soon. And I definitely hope sometime I can play my music for all of you. God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Nachito Herrera, for sharing what was such a harrowing experience, but just a testament to what's possible when we work with compassion and collaborate, and for giving us a real example that goes beyond statistics about, you know, these are people's lives. As I mentioned before, now in the US, over 245,000 lives lost. Many yes. of them were preventable, and many of them were artists and, you know, essential workers, farmers, factory folks, people who are so important in our lives. I believe now it's Black, Latinx, and Indigenous people can all No, it's one in every thousand of our population yes. has lost a life to COVID. I know a neighbor here in New Orleans who passed, and I'm sure that his death was preventable. And it's devastating what we've lost because of a system that doesn't work. And it's so brilliant to see you here with us today, testament to what's possible and what is, as you said, a result of working together. And, you know, we listen to your call to action, that we make it be known that this is what we need. So next,
I just want to mention one more thing. You know, I want to invite all people, don't believe like this COVID-19 definitely exists, like the no, like every single time we are watching the news or reading the newspaper and we see the numbers, keep this in mind. These numbers, they have a name, last name behind that. This is not just mathematical numbers. This is our people are dying day by day, minute by minute, second by second, because it hasn't been taken exactly the right action to try to prevent and stop this. So please keep that in mind. These are brothers, sisters, cousins, nephews, father, grandfather, great grandparents are dying because we don't want to definitely continue to work with this. Something is going to save the world, which is just one word, collaboration. So thank you, and I hope to see you soon.
Thank you so much. And
gracias.
We hope to hear you play. Thank you.
Anytime.
And next, I have the honor of presenting Alicia Hrabko. I apologize deeply for mispronouncing your name. Alicia Hrabko began working with Cuban solidarity campaigns in the early 1990s and just has a wealth of experience and leadership in internationalism, in journalism, in solidarity work. She describes having been inspired by the humanity of the Cuban struggle for peace and sovereignty. And as I mentioned at the top of this session, she has many hats. She's the co-chair of the Cuban Nobel Prize Committee, speaking to Cuba's right to be honored for their leadership in medical internationalism. She's been a co-chair of the National Network on Cuba, co-editor of Resumen Latinoamericano, a really critical news source. She's part of the US Bureau and is the US coordinator of the International Committee for Peace, Justice, and Dignity. Thank you so much for joining us today, Alicia Hrabko, and I'll pass the mic to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And really great presentations. I learned a lot today, and I'm glad Nachito is doing good. You know, we are all very worried about what is going on in the U.S. We are facing a health catastrophe. Over 10 million cases of COVID and more than 242,000 deaths. And it's worse. According to the late figures, in the last few weeks, the U.S. registered 100,000 cases daily. The only way the planet can be saved is through solidarity and collaboration. And I think we have heard a lot today about this. There is a growing solidarity movement around the world to nominate the Henry Reed Brigade for the Nobel Peace Prize. It started in Europe and extended all over the world, including the United States. We are very proud to be part of this campaign. John Kirk mentioned a lot about the Henry Reed Brigade. In those 15 years since it started, more than 13,000 Cuban collaborators assisted 4 million patients in 53 countries, saving lives. The Henry contingent has so far 53 brigades to 38 at the request of those governments. This unprecedented effort involved more than 3,800 Cuban health professionals, 61.2% of them. We are not naive about the Nobel Peace Prize. Although this year it was given to the World Food Program, in the past, war criminals like Henry Kissinger received it. Just to give an example, I say we're not naive because we know what the Nobel Peace Prize is about. Of course, we would be happy if this well-deserved award, but the main, you know, if it's given to them, but the main goal of the campaign, of this international campaign, is to counter the lies about Cuba's effort to save lives. At the same time, Henry Reed Brigade was facing the pandemic in the war, the Trump government was tightening the blockade of Cuba to inhumane limits and unleashing a ferocious campaign of slander and lies against Cuban medical cooperation. Going to the extreme of pressuring and threatening the government of countries that requested aid from Cuba. We have created a webpage, www.cubanobel.org, that account with more than 36,000 endorsers. We have organized a webinar with Cuban doctors from Belize, Jamaica, and Barbados, and we will continue organizing more. From September 1st to January 31st, the Nobel Committee will receive nominations for those who are qualified to do so, according to the statute of the Nobel. Today, we can confirm that the Henry Reed Brigade has been officially nominated before the Nobel Committee by many organizations and individuals, such as the World Peace Council based in Athens, Adolfo Pérez Esquivel, the Nobel Peace Prize from Argentina, 21 deputies and senators of Congress of Colombia, 3 members of the British Parliament and 2 of the Scotland Parliament, members of Congress of Chile, France, Ecuador, many more. We are happy to announce that in the US, more than 200 US university professors are supporting the nomination done and accepted by the Nobel Committee of 7 US professors and academics. And those who support them are from Harvard, Yale, Stanford, Brown, and Columbia, to the State University of Massachusetts, Maryland, and California. If you are current or emeritus professor and want to add your name to www.cubanobel.org/letter. I would like to end with the well phrase of Jose Martí that reflect why so many people are working to nominate the Reed Brigade to the Nobel Peace Prize. Amor con amor se paga. Abajo el bloqueo, viva Cuba, la solidaridad de los pueblos.
Que viva, perdón, I had my mic muted. Thank you so much for that wonderful celebration of Cuba's contribution. And we put in the chat box the link and invite everyone to look at the Nobel Peace Prize for Cuba website and sign the petition and learn more about the Henry Reeve Internationalist Medical Brigade, which has played such a critical role in responding to disasters and to pandemics and viruses across the global South. And we would hope here in the US and also in Canada, once we defeat the blockade, and also just the tremendous medical internationalism that's existed since anti-colonial times. I was born and raised in Zimbabwe, where many of our medical staff and folks in the public health system had been trained in Cuba or had been taught by people who were trained in Cuba. And definitely the impact is reverberating. So next, I will introduce a video, Get Out of Cuba's Way campaign, in which we see young people talking about how the US needs to get out of Cuba's way in their quest for self-determination and creating the world we need to see. So Allison, if you could please cue that, thank you very much.
First and foremost, our hearts go out to the families worldwide whose relatives have tragically succumbed to the deadly corona pandemic.
We have heard all of the conspiracy theories. Every night, the news reinforces panic and anger.
By the time they finish with all this doom and gloom, you would think that on this entire planet, no one cares.
In case you're wondering, we're talking about none other than Cuba, a nation that gives an entirely different meaning to the red, white, and blue.
The love and appreciation that Cuba has received worldwide for fighting the corona pandemic is well deserved.
The truth is, this is nothing new. Go and look up the Chernobyl disaster in 1986, the Ebola outbreak in West Africa from 2014 to 2016, and the natural disaster in Haiti, to name a few.
The tragedy is, there is only one nation that is too proud and arrogant to accept Cuba's help, the United States of America.
A very crucial point that we cannot gloss over is that a significant portion of the nations that welcome the Cuban medical personnel do not agree with the political direction of their government and revolution. meaning that Cuba is willing to treat people in other nations that have been hit by pandemics and natural disasters that are not socialist or revolutionary.
15 years ago, the Bush administration ignored Cuba's offer to send a 1,500-member medical brigade to the Gulf region to deal with Hurricane Katrina.
This time around, not only is the Trump administration ignoring Cuba's willingness to deploy a medical brigade to touch down on U.S. soil and treat patients with the deadly COVID-19 pandemic and send the medicine called Interferon Alpha 2B.
Unfortunately, this ridiculous and hateful posture is falling on deaf ears. Italy welcomed Cuban medical personnel to fight COVID-19 and COVID-2 with open arms.
The U.S. government rejects or ignores the fact that Cuban medical personnel are ready to join the fight to eradicate the corona pandemic on U.S. soil. For my generation, all that confirms that your contempt and disregard for poor people and all humanity is simply unfathomable.
You have a member of France's parliament urging and pleading with his government to bring the Cuban medical personnel to France right now. You have 45 nations who have lined up courageously and demanding Interferon Alpha 2B. The truth is, Cuba is willing to overlook 635 assassination attempts on the life of Comandante Fidel Castro. 635. The Bay of Pigs invasion in 1961. And last but not least, an illegal racist blockade aimed at crushing their economy and patriotic spirit.
Well, that being said, what is the problem?
Yeah, what is the problem?
Are you angry that the medical brigade Cuba is willing to send to the U.S. in the blink of an eye is named after Henry Reeves, a.k.a. Englantino, the little Englishman, the U.S. citizen that fought in the Cuban army for 7 years?
Because he was Caucasian, does that remind you too much of John Brown at the raids of Harper's Ferry?
The bottom line is in the name of all the fallen victims who transitioned due to COVID-19 and COVID-2. We are going on record to make one simple statement. We are emphatically demanding that the Henry Reeves Medical Brigade be allowed to come to the United States immediately. This includes the FDA allowing Interferon Alpha 2B to be sent to U.S. borders and given to all people in need, regardless of their economic situation.
Before Dr. King was assassinated by the FBI and the CIA, he was organizing the Poor People's Campaign. What Cuba is doing for the world with their doctors is a continuation of that campaign. As African children, we are comfortable making this demand. You need to be comfortable when you hear it.
Africa is our home, and that will never change. So when we say Cuba is our home away from home, we hope we don't sound strange, because we don't want African people to be confused. This is something we must explain. In Cuba, we are fighting in a revolution that people are fighting to sustain. In Cuba, everyone has free healthcare and education. We don't understand why this isn't the goal of every single nation. When people hear the truth about Cuba, they say miracles never cease. We respond to them by saying, let's end exploitation and racism and bring about real world peace. We know we are in danger, but we have no fear, because our African ancestors' fighting spirit makes us see things very clear. In Cuba, we are praised for our vision and bravery for how we overcame colonialism and slavery. Mother Africa is our home, and that will never change. So when we say Cuba is our home away from home, we hope we don't sound strange.
Nuestro hogar lejos de casa por el pie con el chum. La madre África es nuestro hogar, y eso nunca cambiará. Así que cuando decimos que Cuba es nuestro hogar lejos de casa, esperamos que no suene extraño. ¿Por qué? Porque no queremos que los africanos se confundan. Esto es algo que debemos explicar. En Cuba somos parte de una revolución que todo el mundo está luchando para sostener. En Cuba todo el mundo tiene atención médica y educación gratuita. No entendemos por qué este no es el objetivo de cada nación. Cuando la gente oye la verdad sobre Cuba, dicen que los milagros nunca cesan. Respondemos diciéndoles que pongamos fin a la explotación y el racismo y luego que traigamos la paz al mundo real. Sabemos que estamos en peligro, pero no tenemos ningún miedo, porque el espíritu de lucha de nuestros ancestros africanos nos hacen ver las cosas muy claras. Cuba es a menudo elogiada por su visión y valentía, debido a cómo vencimos el colonialismo y la esclavitud. La madre África es nuestro hogar, y eso nunca cambiará. Así que cuando decimos que Cuba es nuestro hogar lejos de casa, esperamos que no suene extraño.
Get out of Cuba's way.
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 Cuba still willing to put all hands on deck and serve us like waiters, man, ain't known for it. Sending their doctors like troops and indoctrinating our doctors, well, excuse me, intellectually inspired so we can get down to the truth. But what happened to it's all about the youth? If you think about it, we've been out of school for a few. But of course, that's on nobody's mind right now. We just enjoying our free time right now. Catching up on old folks for lost time right now. But you think it's smart to take a break in a time like now? But let me get back on topic. See, isn't it interesting how Italy had the highest amount of cases, then soon after they requested Cuba's help for their patients? But now the US numbers are higher than all. While the people who were in office waiting for trauma on call, Trump said we should save money and fire them all. I mean, what should we do? As a people, I mean, what can we do? Let's come together to support something that has already been in the works.
Thank you so much to young people, particularly of the African diaspora, African descendant, Black youth speaking up. The blockade makes no sense under any logic that isn't absolutely racist and imperialist and evil. And it's always refreshing when young people remind us of how things should be. And one of those things that should be is that the U.S. needs to get out of Cuba's way, and that Cuba is a homeland to many of us, responsible or played a critical role in our liberation struggles and in charting a distinct path. And so thank you for that video. I'm not sure who created it, but we will be sure to share the recording of this with you all, and you'll get to see it again. So I'll pass over to Allison, who will be starting us off in the discussion section. There have been a lot of questions, so good luck, Allison.
Yeah, it's true. Thank you, Pambana. We are here at, you know, a few minutes before the 2-hour mark, but we want to just entertain a few questions, make sure we can talk to our experts and people that have given their time to be with us here tonight. So we will go ahead and start a few questions. If anyone has anything else they want to add, please add it to the Q&A box. It's something that tonight is really just a beginning. It's the second session of the U.S.-Cuba International Conference happening this weekend, and we have another one tomorrow morning, which we'll put the information for, which is also going to be heavily based on hearing about building a broader Cuba solidarity movement. But for now, let's have some questions, especially about what we can all do to increase U.S., Cuba, Canada, medical, and other collaboration. There's been a few questions that have come through. We might kind of mash some questions together so that we can get everyone's idea across. But we really thank everyone for joining us tonight and for being here, for your participation. The first question I wanted to address towards Dr. Samira Adri and John Kirk. People are interested to hear more about how the blockade has hindered Cuba's fight against COVID. Any of the other panelists can also join in and answer.
One of the first things that to be pointed out is that there was a supply of personal equipment which had been provided by China I think it was Avianca, the Colombian company, the air company, which is owned by American investors, refused to transport the personal equipment precisely because it was afraid of falling afoul of US legislation. So I think that there's a basic ingrown fear of doing anything that in the Trump era could lead to legal action being taken against anybody who wanted to help Cuba. It's absolutely ridiculous because this is a basic human rights question. The whole universe is facing COVID. Here there was a donation of humanitarian medical equipment, and precisely because of fear of retaliation from the Bush administration, it didn't get through. Samira, what can you add?
Yes, thank you, John. That was one key example, and we were all there when that news came across that they were blocking efforts for this essential equipment to arrive. And it was disheartening to see that even in a global pandemic, such actions will be, or decisions will be taken. Another critical piece to this whole struggle was the use of ventilators. And these ventilators that we utilize in the treatment of more critical patients, their prices have gone up. And not only that, the access to be able to buy what's on the market is completely hindered by the blockade. And so it forced the Cuban government and its health system to do their best to recycle older pieces in order to keep the ventilators that were on the island working. And these are ventilators that are not as new as what maybe we'd have in some of these our hospitals here in the States. So it forced people to be really innovative and to reuse and reutilize certain parts that they would find in order to keep these ventilators working and functional in order to deliver effective treatment to these patients.
And a final sort of note to add, the fact that the Trump administration has now forbidden or made it impossible for Western Union to send remittances to families to buy food in stores. This is another criminal action that needs to be denounced. So that hundreds of Western Union outlets in Cuba have been closed down again because people are afraid of falling afoul of US law. So it's not just medical the situation, but the blockade is so cruel. It is now prohibiting remittances being sent legally to families in Cuba.
Most definitely. I concur with Don on that. It's not just medical. It's the most basic supplies that we take for granted every day here. And I know people had struggles stateside and elsewhere in terms of getting basic supplies for their homes and food and all that. But just imagine the situation in Cuba before the pandemic has always been tough in getting basic food and other supplies that are needed for everyday life, toiletries and all of that. But due to the blockade, all of that just became exacerbated. All that stress and all that scarcity became exacerbated. And be it as it may, the Cuban government continues to fight to provide for its people, basing its production, its own production in, you know, creating avenues for people to be able to rely on its own production. However, that is not enough. There are things that cannot be produced in Cuba right now. And unfortunately, you can't buy them because they're not in the stores either. And it's super stressful. And these are some of the more basic struggles that we all face in the world, that even if you don't answer those basic questions, you cannot think of your health in general. You cannot aspire to do other things if you are scrambling for food and basic necessities. So definitely the blockade is strangling life as it is, and this pandemic is not helping either.
Thank you, Dr. Samira Adri and John Kirk. Dr. Adjou, do you want to add about how people can get involved in the Latin American School of Medicine, how they can apply? Just shortly, a lot of people asked, and I know you responded in the chat, but maybe if you wouldn't mind just advising people how to do that as well.
Yes, I'd be happy to. So in order to apply for the Elam Scholarship, we'd advise you to go to the IFCO website, www.ifconews.org. At that website, you can click on the tab for the medical school application and request an application. Earlier in the chat, I posted some of the basic requirements for the scholarship, for you to be considered for the scholarship. You need to be between the ages of 18 and 35 years old, need to be a US citizen. You need to have completed basic college level basic sciences, such as 1 year of biology with lab, 1 year of organic chemistry with lab, 1 year of general chemistry with lab, and 1 year of physics with lab, all combined with an average of at least a B average in those classes. So those are the basic requirements. And if you meet those requirements, please apply. We are thrilled to be an organization that helps administer this scholarship and present candidates to be considered by the Ministry of Health in Cuba to receive them. And it's an amazing opportunity. Can't stress enough how this kind of action shows that knowledge has no monetary value. And what we are learning and gaining from this whole experience of being trained in Elam, there is no monetary value at all. So we encourage you all to apply and spread the word about it.
Thank you very much. I also wanted to mention that the video that we watched, a number of people have been asking how they can access it. Cheryl posted in the chat how to access it. You need to send her an email and she will put you in touch with the campaign and those that made it. The video is produced by Obi Egbuna and the Zimbabwe-Cuba Friendship Association as part of the Get Out of Cuba's Way campaign. And so we're really excited to be able to share it with you all tonight. And if you would need to go ahead and you wanna share the video to get in touch with the campaign, it's a good idea to email Cheryl@nnoc.info and she will put you in touch. For the next question tonight, I wanted there are some people that want to elaborate a bit on the resolutions and how more people can get involved with resolutions. So Pambana, do you want to ask that one?
Yes, absolutely. So there were a few, so I'll just kind of stack them and put them to the resolutions committee. So one of them was, once resolutions are passed, how can health workers and health agencies get involved in implementing them? Then a comment and question. In San Francisco, we were able to pass a Saving Lives resolution unanimously, and many health workers supported this effort. We are looking for ways for city agencies and healthcare workers to be involved in implementing the resolution's mandate for cooperation. What are your ideas about doing this? In particular, are there ways to set up health worker to health worker virtual meetings with Cuban health workers in countries not impacted by the blockade? Somebody else had suggested perhaps in Jamaica, the blockade that shamefully keeps us in the US from connecting directly to health workers in Cuba. That came from Diana Block in the Bay Area Venceremos Brigade. And there was also a series of comments as well as questions about approaching the mayor's conference. So I believe those questions are to, yes, Nancy, Rita, and Marcy.
Rita, you know, a lot of the resolutions, especially the most recent ones, have a ask in terms of trying to you know, asking them to contact health departments and community health. Also, you know, the U.S. representatives but, you know, I mean, it's just a resolution. It's not that you have to do have to follow up to make sure that they do what they say they're going to do. Rita worked on, and Nesbitt also worked on the San Francisco. I don't know if you have anything to add, Rita.
Well, you know, these are really good questions and we're just grappling with them ourselves. One thought I have as somebody who, you know, worked in the public health system for a long time, you know, it makes a huge difference when you identify key allies or champions that are in some way associated with university medical center or county medical clinics or hospital health departments. It makes sense to try to contact them and sit down and you know, share the resolution with them and get their thoughts. It takes pressure, you know, it takes pressure. Whatever municipality or organization passed the resolution, you know, they are worded a little differently. Whatever the asks are in the resolution that got passed need to be specifically followed up on. And the, one other thing, someone asked about the Conference of Mayors, and I saw a post that the next one isn't until June 2021. So that would be a long range idea. We welcome people to join our discussions in the committee because we're just now starting to look at, you know, how we take them further. Our focus has been on getting them passed. And we need to develop these other strategies for implementation. It also helps to know medical providers, you know, not only Elam graduates, of course, but medical providers. There's plenty of progressive people who work in our health systems. And I actually think the most important strategy is to identify those people and figure out how to you know, meet on Zoom, to collaborate with them, to get their input on what can be done. You never know, you know, we know of a couple of people who are now on Biden's COVID task force, who we know will be allies. You never know who might be appointed to different bodies. It's, you know, it's creative networking. And you know, starting with whoever you know in the area where you've passed the resolution who works in the health system, you know, find out who they recommend talking to. Because everybody knows some people who have either traveled to Cuba or been interested in Cuba's health system.
Marcy? Yeah, I wanted to just talk about a statewide effort. You heard this morning or earlier today from Sandy Pappas, and she initiated a resolution in the Minnesota State Senate. And what she did is she started following up immediately as soon as she introduced the resolution. And that's something that you could do with a mayor, with a city council person, that they could follow up to with in partnership with people in the community. So Sandy contacted our governor, asked him to take action on the recommendations in the resolution. She's contacted Michael Osterholm, who's on Biden's COVID task force. So she's been a really good partner with us, with the community group that I'm working with. It's called the Solidarity Committee on the Americas. And we, you know, she's been a really great partner in trying to approach people. So she's able to use the power of her position with our community efforts, grassroots efforts.
One other thing. John Waller posted in the chat that in Western Washington, the Physicians for a National Health Program did a webinar on saving lives. And he is suggesting that contacting committees, organizations in other cities, and ask them to do that, and that speakers could be provided.
Right, and also from the question from San Francisco about getting healthcare professionals together, I would suggest, instead of reinventing the wheel, to go through already existing groups and organizations, like it might be unions or other community healthcare organizations, to see if they would get on board and trying to organize something there. And the part of the resolutions, it's not only to garner support for ending the blockade and medical collaboration, but like what John Kirk had said, you know, this is the greatest story never told. One thing about getting the resolution out there and talking to people in your community, bringing it before a city council or a democratic club or your union, is getting the story out. And that's how we can garner support and educate the public, as well as pass resolutions.
Thank you so much, key organizers in getting those resolutions passed. We invite you to please look in the chat box, everybody. Go to the Google form. It's really simple. Express some interest. We'll reach out. We want to support you in making this happen and getting more resolutions passed, and just generally linking you up to Cuba Solidarity work as we will make 2021 the year that we defeat the U.S. blockade against Cuba. So we're now in closing time. So apologies that we weren't able to answer all questions. There's one remaining question that I'm going to ask John Kirk to answer and have that be his closing remarks. And then if please all panelists, you could prepare just some brief closing remarks as we end this call to action for today and invite everyone to tomorrow as well. So John, the question asked was, what lessons did the Cubans learn from their successful battle against Ebola in West Africa that they have applied in Cuba and those in the Henry Reeve Brigade are implementing in other countries?
A few things come to mind. I think, first of all, political will, being determined to collaborate, to work with the local community. Whenever Cubans go abroad on a medical mission and having sort of worked with the Henry Reeve in El Salvador, when they arrive, it's very important to realize that they don't go with an agenda. They go and say to the local government, where can we most help? Where is the greatest need? So I think that lessons learned were to collaborate, to listen to local needs, to follow initiatives from locals who know well, far better than someone who is coming in. The Cubans don't impose their will, they listen and react. And finally, the ability, and Cuba, I having sort of traveled to Cuba for many, many years, I interviewed 270 Cuban internationalistas for two books that I wrote. And I don't mind talking about these books because all the royalties go to MEDIC and also to Washington Office on Latin America. But both organizations do great work in Cuba. But one of the things that really impressed me when I interviewed 270 people, this is over a 15-year period, was the fact that it's in the Cuban DNA. Cubans work abroad precisely because everybody knows somebody who has worked abroad on a medical mission. Cubans are taught from daycare centers that solidarity is an obligation. You don't have to be number one. You have to share what you have. As several Cuban politicians have said, we don't give our leftovers. We share what we have. And I think that these were lessons that they learned in dealing with Ebola, which they have used in COVID. And it is extraordinary to see just what they have done.
Thank you so much. And certainly that is a central part of the Cuban spirit and work, is not giving what's extra, but giving what they have. And I recall a webinar in which members of the international medical team across the Caribbean were speaking, and Lee Schlenkler will be able to tell me who it was, answered the question, what is the difference or what is your relationship with the Cuban Revolution as medical practitioners? And they said, well, we are the revolution. We are this process. And it's a central part of who they are, building a world with solidarity and cooperation. So one fruit of such struggles, Dr. Samir Adri, if you could share your closing remarks, and then we'll have Dr. Andy Coates.
Definitely. Thank you all for such a great evening. I would like to say, quoting Comandante en Jefe Fidel Castro, when he said, el éxito de la medicina cubana en cualquier lugar del mundo está en preservar la salud de las personas, de las familias, de las comunidades y del medio ambiente. And what he's saying there is that the success of Cuban medicine is in any part of the world, lies in its ability to preserve the health of individuals, of families and communities, as well as the environment. And that is a message that when he said it a while back was novel, and it's still resounding now in our approach to tackling what is all happening with us globally, not just with COVID, but with climate change and everything. We must pay attention and we must be accountable to each other and to our environment. And we must use what we have learned over the centuries from our ancestral peoples to empower us for solution seeking. This is not the time for selfishness. That has been the lay of the land for too long, and it has proved fruitless. This is now the time for solidarity and collaboration, as Brother Nachito said, must be the way forward. And we must call, we must put the light on the truth of the matter. We must shed light on the hypocrisy of our situation nationally and globally, where we put a few people's wealth over human life, and that is not what it's about. And it speaks to what Comandante Che Guevara also said when he said the life of a single human being is worth a million times more than the property of the richest man on earth. So these great leaders did not just speak these things because they were beautiful and worth saying. They spoke them because they believed them, and they were fighting and acting in that belief system. And I encourage all our comrades, brothers and sisters in the struggle, do not give up hope, continue to work, and know that every grain that you have contributed is not in vain. I am a recent recipient of all those struggles that you have been fighting for a long time. And I hope that as well as my colleagues will be able to continue that essential work. So we have a long road to go, but we are not giving up, and we should continue. Viva Cuba y hasta la victoria siempre.
Que viva. Dr. Andy Coates?
Well, I don't know if I can follow such an eloquent comrade appropriately. Thank you so much, Dr. Adri. Amazing. I would like to say that we're up against these same people, the Malthusian ideology that radicalized the generation of 1848, the idea that some people deserve to die. It's a shocking ideology. It's a hateful and murderous ideology. And we can change the world because we have the example of Cuba, and because we have each other. In the United States, there's an old labor slogan that an injury to one is an injury to all. And in Cuba, we have that put into practice with organizing the health delivery system around that principle. And so we can go forward strongly, and we should have confidence. I'm very, very grateful to be part of this movement, and I'm just humbled to meet such amazing people. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Next, Rita Baroque, if you could please share your closing remarks, and then Dr. John Oswald.
Sorry. you know, all I can say is that it's obviously time to rededicate ourselves. We have reason for optimism. It's all been discussed already today. I just want to thank everyone who participated in initiating and passing resolutions, and who participated in our making our video. I hope that everyone in the participants is really going to fill out the Google form so we know how to be in contact. You know, we need you to do that to take this beyond today's wonderful conference. And let us know what assistance you need to take action in your area. And never think that your local actions don't matter, because they do. And collectively, it's what will enable us to win. And I'm very roughly paraphrasing our esteemed Ambassador Cabanas in saying that. I don't think he'd mind. He said it on a previous webinar, that they consider the passing of these resolutions to be quite significant. And I consider it an honor to be part of that. And I invite everybody else to join us. Thank you.
Dr. John Oswald.
Yes, no, I've really been inspired by all the remarks at tonight's session. And, you know, being sort of a pragmatist, one thing that I'm really looking forward to is finding those one or two projects. And, you know, whether it's to be participating in large scale clinical trials around one of the vaccines, or whether it's some very, you know, pragmatic application of contact tracing, or whether it's even tonight, an example was the homeopathic medication I'm familiar with, and there's been a lot of notoriety around the use of the interferon medication, but the homeopathic treatment, or just if there are, you know, two or three really practical, directly applicable types of initiatives that we could seize upon and run with. I think it'll make it a lot more meaningful, you know, to, you know, leaders in both the United States and Cuba.
Thank you very much. Alicia Rapko, if you could share your closing remarks.
Well, you know, I hear so many wonderful things tonight. And the only thing that I can say is that we shouldn't rely on the new government of the United States. We can shift weight for them to decide what is going to be the future of the relationship. We have to push. We have to push everywhere to make sure that this is going to happen, that the people of the United States will be the one that decides how our relationship with Cuba will be. And we hope that it's going to be better, but we don't know. We may have to keep fighting as we have been fighting for the last, I don't know how many years. I don't want to say 60 because I was little, but that's it.
Thank you so much for encouraging us to keep organizing, keep pushing. And I just wanted to thank again Obi Egbuna and the Zimbabwe Cuba Friendship Association for that awesome video, Get Out of Cuba's Way, part of their campaign. As a Zimbabwean, I'm sorry, I missed the authorship of that awesome video. But I will now pass on to Allison, who will share some concrete next steps. And please, everyone, join the struggle. Thank you to our speakers who just have such a wealth of information and a real commitment and conviction to build a better world. So Allison, if you could take it away. And again, gratitude and admiration to you all.
Thank you very much, Pambana. We are we are here, and we've had a really incredible evening of talking to one another about the next steps and how we all need to get involved. And it's really been an honor to be here with everybody. But I wanted to tell about some next steps, one of which is not so many hours from now. I wanted to emphasize session 3 begins starting at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. Pacific, tomorrow of the U.S.-Cuba Normalization Conference. Let's build an unstoppable momentum to defeat the U.S. blockade of Cuba in 2021. We are going to keep organizing and keep mobilizing and uniting through the Saving Lives campaign and our many other facets of our work in order to defeat this criminal U.S. blockade. Tomorrow is a time to hear from leading activists from the U.S., Canada, and Quebec, as well as to hear from distinguished speakers like Fernando Gonzalez, our Cuban Five hero, who is now the president of the Cuban Institute of Friendship with the Peoples, as well as Cuba's newest and new ambassador to the United Nations. This will be his first speaking event. So you use the same Zoom link in order to attend the meeting tomorrow and join in. And I really encourage people to do so. And we'll be sharing it again on Facebook. Tonight's Facebook video is already up on many pages, but including the page of the National Network on Cuba, as well as the video from earlier today for our first successful part of this U.S.-Cuba Normalization International Conference. I want to give a big thank you again to Dr. Samira Adri, Dr. Andy Coates, John Kirk, Dr. John Oswald, Nachito Herrera, Alicia Rapko, to the Get Out of Cuba's Way campaign and their beautiful video, and also to my co-chair, Pambana. Thank you so much for your time and your energy today, and let's continue organizing together. I wanted to also put up some photos you might want to take a picture of with your phone, or write down the information on them about tomorrow's session, but also about the resolutions, including a beautiful layout done by Cheryl Labash of the resolution that was passed in Sacramento. So thank you all for your continuing work. We'll see you tomorrow morning. Have a good rest, and let's continue building to defeat this criminal blockade. Viva Cuba. Thanks, Pambana. Thank you to everyone else for joining us. We will see you all tomorrow morning.